Being special brings a great feeling. A feeling of love, care, importance, and sometimes uniqueness. Humans are special one way or another, and it doesn't matter what they look like, their skin color, age, or height. But what makes you special? Special numbers exist as well. We know that the number 911 is a special number used to connect callers to emergency services for countries in North America. In Europe and parts of Asia, the special number 112 is used. In Africa, countries like Nigeria and Seychelles use 112 as well. Similarly, some special IP addresses exist because not all IP addresses can apply to every given scenario. Why can't I assign 255.255.255.255 to my computer? Why does the device have to be configured with 192.168 and not 192.167? For a moment, let's forget about what these addresses cannot be used for and focus on what they are and can be used for. Now, there are five classes of IP addresses. The class D are specially reserved for what is called multicast communication. This means when one device needs to send data to multiple destinations at once, then a multicast address can be used as the destination address. Devices that need the information sent to that multicast address must join a multicast group. Class E IP addresses are reserved for research and experimental purposes, so you may never get to see any device configured with them. But the classes A, B, and C are configured on device interfaces to implement Layer 3 communication. In this category, we find the 192.168.0.0/16 block of IP addresses. Let's find out what they are and how they are used on today's special IP addresses. Hello guys, we'll talk about special IP addresses. There will be three videos for the entire presentation, but before we begin, let's introduce a very fun concept. Computer network architectures. Who likes the sound of that? Sadly, however, the SMS or email received afterwards isn't as pleasing to the eyes as this sound is to the ears. Automated teller machines or ATMs are most widely known as service points for customers whenever they need money. Customers take money from the ATM, but the ATM never takes money from the customers. One may argue that some ATMs take money from customers in the form of deposits, which is true. But here's a question. Who deposited that money? The customer. Who will withdraw that money? The customer. Who will make transfers, buy airtime, and pay bills with the machine? Still the customers. In summary, the customers are completely dependent on the services of the machine, and the machine never depends on the customers for anything. Hence, customers are called clients, and ATMs are called servers. Clients and servers communicate with each other, but a device is called a server by virtue of the services it provides, and not based on the direction in which data flows. This kind of architecture is called client-server architecture, or hierarchical architecture, since by observation, the server is higher in hierarchy and functionality than the clients. The second type of architecture will be demonstrated with an image or video sharing process between smartphones using the mobile app called Zendar. Devices are initially connected to each other wirelessly, and then device A can request a file from device B, and vice versa. Each device depends on the other for a service. Hence, we say the service is distributed between them, since no device has a dedicated role like in the previous example. It's like having a peer group, that is, people of the same age, status, or interest coming together. No person is superior to the other and they assist one another. This kind of architecture is called peer-to-peer, distributed, or flat architecture. When this kind of connection is done wirelessly, the architecture is called an ad-hoc architecture. Before we get to the best part, Please take a moment to hit the subscribe button and as well turn on bell notifications so you'll be the first to know when we release a new video like this one. Now that we know that a server is a computer with dedicated functionalities, let's briefly describe three common services provided by servers on computer networks. First off is the web service provided by a web server. We use this every day through HTTP or HTTPS on our browser. HTTP is an acronym for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. To transfer means to move a thing from one point to another, and a protocol means a set of rules used for communication. But what is hypertext? The thing is, regular text like this one on the screen are called plain text, and you usually cannot do much with them apart from reading them or copy and paste actions. With hypertext, you can do much more than that, like linking two or more documents together using what is called hyperlinks within the hypertext. This can be easily seen on a Wikipedia page as blue-colored text that redirects you to other pages when you click on them with your mouse. This lays the foundation of the web. Most web pages are formatted using hypertext markup language, or HTML, so they can be linked together and then stored on the respective servers like Facebook, Google, or Twitter. When a client uses HTTPS in the web browser, he is about to initiate a hypertext transfer process, and upon specifying the server like facebook.com, he downloads the HTML files to his local computer, and the web browser displays it as one fine-looking Facebook page. To understand DNS, let's do this. 102.132.101.35. This takes us to facebook.com. How hard was it remembering the IP address we just entered for one Facebook server? Now, imagine you had to memorize the IP addresses of all servers for the website you visit. I'm pretty sure you wouldn't like that. Humans more easily remember text than numbers, so with a DNS server, we only need to know the domain names of those websites, and the server will resolve the domain names into IP addresses, so we can have a normal life while browsing the web. This is the minimum knowledge required to learn about special IP addresses more easily in the next couple of videos. Until then, thank you for watching.